Again, to reestablish this truth, we all pray to God. Everybody prays. But I know, because once we pray, we expect the answers to come. But it is not only the answers we should expect, but bigger things. You know, because what you asked for, what I asked for, was based on the beat I knew. The prayer you prayed was based on some knowledge you had. So, based on the information available to you, you prayed to God. But you didn't realize that you did not know many other things, which, if you knew, would have also affected your prayer session, your prayer point. If you knew, for instance, that God wanted to give you 10 blessings in 1 week, if you knew that, if by the Holy Ghost you knew that, then you wouldn't be asking God, or you wouldn't have asked God for 2 things in a month. But because you didn't know, God had planned to give you 10 things in a week. You only asked God to give you 2 things in a month because you didn't know his plans. And this is the matter with every one of us. We don't know how limited we are before we go to God in prayers. We don't know how or what things God has put in place before we, you know, go to God in prayers. So when we now pray, it is only what we've prayed for we expect to happen. And God is saying, look, when you pray to me, I will answer you. I know that's all you are waiting for. But don't just wait for the answer. Also look out for the great and mighty things you are not aware of. Look out for the great and mighty things. Look out for remarkable secrets you do not know about things to come. It's amazing. Amen? So this is the way it is. It shows the human limitation. It shows how ignorant we are of God's original intent. And that's why I keep saying that most of the time, the prayers of the righteous are wrong. Or not complete. This is to tell you, because we all are, you know, we all busy of this. We only expect the answers to to our prayers. And God said, no, don't just wait for the answers. Look out also for the wondrous things, marvelous things that you could never figure out on your own. I love this translation. This captures what I'm trying to say. Call to me and I will answer you. Full stop. I will tell you marvelous and wondrous things that you could never figure out on your own. This is what I'm trying to explain. Marvelous things, wondrous things you could never figure out on your own. Now, which explains the point that because there were things you could not figure out on your own, your prayer was actually limited. All of us suffer in this area. And so when we are so convinced, so hopeful that yes, I prayed. Oh, Anna said, for this child I prayed. And God has answered me. You know, we celebrate Anna all the time, but Anna also was short-sighted. Anna didn't know that many more things were tied to the prayer she prayed. So she didn't wait for more things God was going to show her. She only waited for the boy. And the boy came. Said, for this I prayed. For this I prayed. She was wrong. Because there were many more answers, many more things God was going to communicate to her from that same one prayer she prayed. And but this same Anna, I'm not trying to knock Anna, but we need to know it's by revelation we have all this. So this is, everybody has based their prayer request on Hannah's prayer. We do respect, please. When you say, for this I pray, it shows that you are still ignorant of the many more wondrous and marvelous things. You couldn't figure that God was already in his wisdom communicating to you. But because you were not expectant, you just got the answer and walked away. Simple. So Hannah was wrong. Hannah was short-sighted, just as we all are. As soon as we can say, for this, even in our testimony, it shows how short-sighted we are. I asked God to leave X for me, and he has done it every time. God, we should cry for that person. Because God, who has said it in his word, could not have just sent the answer to the person. Many more secrets were already on the way to that same person. But he didn't wait for them. Because what he had prayed for, he had got. Are we together? This is the thing. So, Father, we are even so, at some point in time, so cocky in our testimonies. Cocky and a little bit arrogant in our testimonies. I know how much I prayed. I had to fast. I fasted. And I said, God, dear, and God did it. Every time, God, I went to the budget 40 days. Wonderful. Thank God for your life, for my life too. But was that all there was to be? From that prayer you prayed, I prayed. No. Because this scripture is so powerful that we must exploit. Call to me or pray to me, and I will answer you. Full stop. I will tell you. This you didn't pray for because you could not figure it out. I will tell you marvelous and wondrous things that you could never figure out on your own. This is serious. Very, very serious. And I did explain using examples of Zacharias and Elizabeth, who had only prayed for their own baby to come. And when the angel came, looked at them, when the angel came and said, your prayer is heard. What you prayed for is now answered, is heard. But he found that after telling him that, he began to say deeper things about the answer which Zechariah and Elizabeth never could have figured out. It tells you that we all suffer here. We can't refer to Mary, but Mary didn't pray. It was God's wisdom that located her. We have chosen you to be the blessed amongst women. But we are talking about Zechariah and Elizabeth that prayed. Let's go to Luke 1. Now, there was in the days of Herod, next verse, because of our time. And they were both righteous before God, walking all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless, wonderful. But they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well advanced in years. So it was that one was serving as priest before God in the order of his division. What happened? According to the custom of the priesthood, his lot fell to burn incense when he went in. Okay, next verse. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. Look at this. When the crowd saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. The angel said to him, do not be afraid, for your prayer is heard. God, your prayer is heart. Now, look at the next. And your wife will bear you a son. He shall call his name John. He had never asked to know the baby's name. He just had asked for a child. Now, today, you go ahead and name our babies before they come. You name our babies. Okay, that's by faith. But we actually do ask God, what would the name of the child be? We just name the baby while waiting for you to come. Which is not wrong. But is it not a higher level? They say, Lord, what has waited this long? What name will this child be? All right. Now, you will have joy and gladness. They didn't pray for this one. And Mary would just at his birth, they never prayed for this one. These were the wondrous and marvelous things they could never figure out. For he will be great in sight of the Lord. They didn't pray for this one. And shall drink neither wine strongly. They could never figure this out. He will also be filled with the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. This was never in the presence of this righteous man and righteous wife. So as righteous as they were, they had no knowledge of this. They only had prayed for their child, maybe for a boy. And here was the answer. Pam. But these details they didn't have because they could not have asked why. They could not have figured it out. He will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. Wow. Can you see how limited we all are? In Christ, we are limitless. But because we don't know what we ought to know, that places on us a heavy limitation. And that's why God says his own people perish because they do not know what they ought to know. Oh, we need to know what we ought to know. Oh, my God. He will also go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah. These were secrets that Zechariah and Elizabeth could never have figured out. So they could not have prayed about it. So they were never expectant of all these things, only the answer, which was the boy. And don't forget that they never also asked for the boy's name. So from the birth of the baby, everything that followed was that which they could never have made their prayer point. Can you see how we need to really humble ourselves? We don't know what we ought to know. In going before the Lord, in the spirit and power of the leader, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Hey. Are you not surprised that the angel, oh, thank you, Jesus. Go back to John 12, 13. Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer is heard. Now, he was careful to use the word is, or the word prayer. He didn't say your prayers are heard. Because they had only prayed for one thing. It was only one prayer. And so they were expecting how many answers? Only one. How many answers did they get eventually? Many. Because the answer was the baby boy. Right from the name John, this couple never prayed. So when you pray, consider one thing that you lack knowledge before you pray. You only prayed based on the knowledge available to you. The knowledge of the need, the knowledge you had of the challenge you were faced with before you prayed. You only knew what was not in place. You never knew what God had put in place. If I want to say was not in place, it's because you didn't know God had put it in place. So it became a prayer point. Are you not shocked that Elijah didn't make it a prayer point when the brook dried up? Why? To him, that was not a prayer point. So, he must have known something. So, at times, when we expect people to be as prayerful as we are, you don't know that they probably know what you don't know. They don't pray the way you do. We want to pray in that religious manner, traditional way. No, that's not the will of the Lord. Jesus said, thank you, Father, because you hear me always. I'm wondering, when he prayed that prayer, because he always answered me, he didn't pray any prayer there, he only thanked the Father. So there were more moments, more times when he prayed, that's not on record. So there must have been some other ways he prayed beyond going to the mountain. Now, I feel I'm going to the mountain every day, and I'm not against that, but they forget that there were many more prayers Jesus prayed that are not recorded. When he was in a solitary place, when John was beheaded, he was there alone. What was he doing? He must have been praying. So he had more times in which he prayed that are not on record. But you could deduce from what he said, Father, thank you because you always hear me. Thank you for hearing me always. But there was no prayer he prayed at that point in time. So he must have prayed which nobody captured. Alright. So this is to again reestablish what we shared the last time. So you can see now, that's from John. His name shall be called John. Maybe we'll go back there. Let's move on. Because you already recalled that. Go back there and you will this it happened. So giving back that MSG, that's in Jeremiah 33. I love it so much. It's so it captures all I'm saying. So now we'll go to start from the from where we stopped. We'll take off from there. I already gave you about 10 points the other time if you were writing. I don't want to go over all that anymore. Number 12. Revelation 3, 17 to 18. Revelation 3. We are examining what I don't know. What you don't know. Even when we want to go to God, we want to fast, which is wonderful. It still shows that the fast I want to do, there are things I do not know. So I would rather fast go to know what I don't know than to just fast because I know I need a thing. That thing which I know I need is not working alone. So every prayer anyone, any child of God prays, there are more answers than the answer. That's why I told Zechariah, your prayer is hard. You, your wife, who have a baby, but full stop. That was the prayer, the single prayer they had prayed. From that point in time, that's why he didn't say your prayers are hard. He said his name will be John. He would operate in the spirit and power of Elijah. He turned hands of children to their father and vice versa. He would do great things. Hey! Those were wondrous things, marvelous things the couple did not know. So whenever you pray, don't go too far before you get cocky in your prayer session and several steps to answer prayers. Remember one thing. By the time the prayer has been answered, it just shows how limited you were and you still are. Because you didn't know that you were meant to expect more things. Deeper and bigger and more marvelous than the single prayer you prayed. Because God knows that if he waits for us to come every time to pray to him, we will never get to. So for one prayer we pray, he gives the answer and he gives more. Okay. In case you will not be chance to pray again. In case you've been praying to say, or they lock your mouth and you can't utter a word. That prayer you pray will have helped you get more things than what you have prayed in 6 months. But if all you were expecting was just that answer, then the angel will tell you, your prayer is hard. You have to get a boy. Bye-bye. Those other things that you said would not have been communicated to him. I pray you wait to see the marvelous, wondrous things God is trying to show you in Jesus' name. It's amazing how true and dependable our God is. Hallelujah. Look at this. Because you say, I am rich, I've become wealthy, and I have need of nothing. Look at the man that thought he needed nothing. He was so made. He said, because you say, I'm rich, I've become wealthy, and I have need of nothing, and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Oh, the person said he was already rich. So I counsel you to buy gold from me. I need to advise you. You don't have gold. Buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich. Oh, he said he was already so rich and wealthy, he needed nothing extra. The Lord said, no. Who told you you are rich? you're still poor, miss you. That is the expectation of heaven. You've not met it yet. We don't call you wealthy in heaven. We see you as still poor and wretched. Well, because we're in the midst of those who are very poor, the little you have, you think is what? He said, no, we still see you. We are wanting to lift you to a level where you can say you are rich. We know what secret you must tap into. I counsel you, buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich. And white garments, that's where you see honest people, very white garments. How deceived you could be. That you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed. And anoint your eyes with eyes of that what? Oh, that you may see. Can you see our lives? If that man had seen well, would he have said he was rich? Talk to me. Would he have said he was wealthy? Would he have said he didn't have nothing more? So he couldn't see well. May we see well in Jesus' name. We need to see beyond the prayer points. We need to wait to see more than the answer. The answer is just the lowest, the smallest of God's responses to that one prayer. So if you focus on just the answer, you have wasted many months. He says that we may see. So we anoint our eyes that we may see. We pray, Lord, anoint our eyes that we may see in Jesus' name. Help us to see. Would you pray that prayer for yourself? In the name of Jesus. I pray you see what God wants you to see in Jesus' name. It is still part of the answers. Part of the prayer you prayed. Just one prayer. That's why it's important. Okay. When Ahithophel went with Absalom, and news got to David. Ahithophel, the professor of counseling, has gone with Absalom. Ha! David said, oh Lord, help me. Whatever advice or counsel it is, turn it into foolishness. David didn't know that that prayer would produce the death of Ahithophel. He didn't pray for him to die. No. But inside that prayer, the answer will produce something more than the answer. So whenever before you pray, get yourself together. Get your acts right. Don't, because prayer is so powerful. When I say this, I'm not knocking prayers, but at least I pray at least a minute a day. I have to tell you what that 1 minute stands for. When people think, oh, Pastor, you're not been praying, I just smile. They want me to pray that religious and, that ecumenical way. No, that's not how it works with me. They mess me on my knees, shouting there, Hey, Papa, 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 Papa. He says, no pray. Who told you? There are many more things we need to do. So what happened in that story? You know the story very well. We need to see more than the answer we are expecting to see. And we shall see well in Jesus' name. We are seeing well in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm wondering why the man said he was rich, wealthy. It tells you that even when we feel good about some things God has blessed us with, there's that question mark we must put. Is this all I could have seen? Are there more things that came with this answer? I didn't wait to see. Lord, anoint my eyes to see. But because we are always too quick to testify, we want to go and testify quickly. I'm not against testimony. I do it a lot. It's powerful. But it's like my friend over there who manufactures some things. Rather than wait to do an excellent job, he's rushing into making profit. He has not finished this work so that when buyers buy and consume the product, they are happy to buy more. He is eager to sell and start making profit. People buy his product, they consume the thing, and say, what's wrong? 2 weeks,
Everything's nonsense. And he tells us what is committed. What has he done? So we are always too eager to give testimonies when we should have waited to see more that God was trying to communicate to us in addition to those answers. I pray that we have understanding in Jesus' name. Matthew 20, this is amazing, very awesome. Matthew 20, then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to him with, she came to Jesus with her two sons, James and John, kneeling down. Now, this was worship. She came kneeling down and asking something from Jesus. She came to worship. Wonderful. She came kneeling down asking something from him. So she came to pray, if you like. And Jesus said to her, what do you wish? What do you want me to do for you? You've knelt down. You've given me worship. That's fine. I give that praise to my Father. But what is it you are desirous of getting from me? She said to him, grant that these two sons of mine may sit, one on your right hand and the other on the left, in your kingdom. Was that good prayer? Of course. That was her desire. Wonderful request. It was, she wasn't really before asking that pastor. Look at the response. Jesus said, you do not know what you ask. Does that explain our case a number of times? That we really do not know what to ask. We don't even know what we have asked for actually means. You do not know what you ask. You came to worship, you came kneeling down to me, I appreciate. And you've asked me that, what would you want to do? You want this, wonderful request, but you don't. You lack knowledge of what to ask. You don't know what you ask. That is the picture of me and you today. We just ask. We don't care to know what it means. I'm sorry, if David knew that his prayer would eventually produce Ahithophel's death, he would have prayed that prayer. And I'm just saying, Lord, save me. The fact that the man's counsel or advice became a foolish one was what he never recovered from. He was an expert in counseling. The Bible says, whatever he took to counsel, it was as if God himself had spoken. So he was I know this advice I've given you is perfect. And truly, that was going to get David killed. Oh, yes. But for the way it was, it allowed him to say, Dabaroo. That's the literal word in English, Dabaroo. You do not know what to ask. Now, let's read on. Are you able? Now, these were the deeper dimensions of that prayer, which she did not wait to find out before asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am about to drink? One, two. Are you able to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And the young man answered, we are able. Now, it was the mother that prayed. It was the son that answered, we are able. She didn't join her to pray the prayer. Jesus told her, you ask what you do not know. And he asked questions. And the son felt, mommy didn't do a good job. The mommy, you jumped ahead. Let's now come in. We are able to drink the cup and to get baptized, same way you will be baptized. Look at this. He said to them, you will indeed drink my cup and be baptized with baptism that I'm baptized with. But to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it is prepared by my Father. Next one. And when the ten had it, they were greatly displeased with the two brothers. What are we saying here? She asked, she came kneeling down. So you find that it's our worshiping him does not translate to our knowing what to ask. You still need to know that this prayer you want to pray shows how short-sighted you are. So it means before actually praying, The first prayer is, Lord, show me what I should pray for. Because if you see what to pray for, you will pray the right prayer. Because we didn't see where we just this is happening. Oh, there's a problem. Oh God. Now, the prayer is praying. This the panic button she's pressing, which he calls prayer, is all because she does not know that what she's panicking about has been sorted out. So if you knew God had sorted out the matter, would you have prayed? No. And because, oh God, are you? It's the Lord Jesus. Don't you care we perish? And you are sleeping on the pillow. Don't you care you perish? He said, You are who? Who is pressing with you? I will never join you to perish. Nor will I let you perish. It shows how short sighted you are. That prayer is wrong. I would never give you out for the enemy to waste. Hallelujah. I declare this morning in the name of Jesus Christ that you will see well. What God is showing you will see well. In Jesus' name. Henceforth, as you pray, it is prayer that God calls prayer. In the name of Jesus. And the answers will come. More than the answers, the wondrous and magic things you didn't know will show. In the name of Jesus. Let's leave this one. Look at yet another one. Look at this scripture. Matthew, again, 24. Matthew 24. Verse 42 to 44. Matthew 24, 42 to 44. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. Watch out, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. Isn't that a serious warning? Watch out. No one knows. And because we don't know what hour Jesus is coming back, that's why we get involved in stuff. We don't know. It says, watch out. Why? You don't know. So prepare yourself as it is coming the next minute. Watch out. Be on the lookout. Be on the lookout. You do not know what hour your Lord will be coming. Does the church really, really know this? Are we actually watching out? Are little things not now weighing us down so badly we think God has abandoned us? Are we conscious of the fact that He's still with us as He has promised that I will never leave nor forsake you? Do we still believe that? Next. But know this. Oh, you do not know what hour your Lord comes, but know this. Isn't that serious? You don't know. But I now put it to you. Know what I'm about to say. That if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. He said, know this. If the master, we call it master bedroom. And that's what you see here. If the owner of the house knew what hour the thief was coming and would come, he would not have allowed him to break into his house. He would have done everything. He would have called the police. He would have called some soldiers. He would have maybe run away from the house itself. If he knew the hour. So how prepared are you for eventualities? How ready are we for the coming of the Lord? That means there is power in knowing what we don't know. When you know, it says you are better prepared. Once you know what you ought to know, you are ahead of many other people who may be in the same class, the same church with you, but they are far behind you because you know deep things. Hallelujah. Therefore, you also be ready. The Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Amen. Looking at what I do not know, which I ought to know. You need to know. So we cannot be in church for the fun of being in church. No, there are deep things, great, marvelous, wondrous things we ought to know. Those are the fringe benefits of being born again. If it's about just going to church, that's churchianity. That's not Christianity, it's churchianity. Christianity is all about the love of Christ. There are dimensions you have to know. You should be hungry to know them. They are your rights. But if you think, I prayed. You prayed. When I hear, I prayed about it. I ask the person, after praying, what did you see? I prayed about it. You prayed and walked away. No wonder. He said, I will answer you and show you great, wondrous manifest you don't know. So wait for those things. Mr. Prayer, know this. Mark 12, 24. We start with verse 22. Verse 22. So the seven had her and left no friend. Talking about, you know, seven men, husband, woman. You know, last of all, the woman died also. So 23, go. Therefore, in the resurrection, when they rise, whose wife will she be? For all seven had her as one. I have to read that so you could see the background. Now, Jesus asked him, he answered them, are you not therefore mistaken? Because you do not know the scriptures, but the power of God. Now, who does not want to see the power of God today? Who doesn't want to see? You don't want to see God's power at all. Who wants to see God's power in his own life, in our own life, in the nation, in the family? He wants to see God's power. It's a kingdom comes by power, by prayer. You can't see prayer here. It's knowledge of the word. That's why the multitude of prayers will not get the job done. It's knowledge. It says, the reason you want to see God's power, but you cannot unless you know the scriptures. Not unless you pray. No. This is what settles the matter here. It said, you err. King James says, you err. You are in error because you do not know the word of God, let alone the power of God. So, knowing God's power, identifying God's power, enjoying the power of God is only a response to the word of God you know, not the prayer you pray. Because the prayer you pray is an uninformed prayer. It's empty. It's not pregnant with the word of God. But when God's word is in you, you know God's word, you pray a few prayers. You think that prayers are lengthy because there's no word content. That's why your prayers are long. And Bible says, be not repetitive as the Pharisees do, or as the Pharisees are. They are always repetitive. They pray in the open place. People get to Israel. They go to the wedding wall. They start praying there. Say, God answers prayers. Yes. So how many of you have to go to church to go and answer? After that prayers. We must all go to Israel. That's a lie. Wedding wall. So if I couldn't go to Israel, I would have been in trouble because God will answer my prayers. No. He said, you do err. Look at you are way off base. And here is why. One, you don't know your Bibles. Two, you don't know how God works. Now, they are linked up. You do not know the word. There's no way you can see the power of God. Because even when God is in motion, when God is moving, you can't identify it. That is God's power. Why? It takes knowledge of the word to know that this is God's power in motion. It takes knowing the scriptures to identify, to activate or actualize or enjoy the power of God. That's why at when God is moving, we cast the devil out. Jesus appeared. The sheep was was about to capsize. You know, the storm was contrary, the waves were contrary. Jesus, knowing they were about to be wasted, he had to suspend nature. He walked on the sea to save them. When they saw him, he said, "Hey, he's a ghost." They were terrified. Why? They did not know. They saw him, but they didn't know it was in the sun. So, if you want to see the power of God, you must know the scriptures. Look at it. Are you not deceived because you don't know the scriptures of the power of God? It is not the power that comes before the word. The word before the power. When you know God's word, you are not far from the power of God. Why did Paul say, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ"? For why? It is the power of God unto salvation. Why did Paul say that? He said, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus, of the word of God. I'm not ashamed because God's word is the power of God unto the saving of his soul, unto deliverance, unto everything." It is not the prayer, it's the word. The word in that prayer makes the prayer prayer. You didn't get me? Ah. The word of God in that prayer makes that prayer prayer. Ah. I'll say it again. God's word in that prayer makes that prayer prayer. If there's no God's word in that prayer, there's no prayer yet. Somebody just spoke and walked away, expecting God to move because he has prayed. When people say, "I prayed," you just have to help them and say, "If you really prayed, did God call it prayer or you call it prayer? Can you share with me what you prayed? Actually, what I prayed? I just want to know if they can assist you. Just to scan the prayer to see whether it had the content of the word. It didn't have it. It is prayer. Because when you made that prayer, God's word was in that prayer. It is prayer. Can I say more? You sure? This is what we have to know. You don't know. We are looking at what we don't know. What we don't know is why prayer is not prayer. It's just some exercise that will bring no result. Well, that will result because of stagnation. There will be failed expectation. What we expect to see will not be because we didn't actually pray. Nobody ever prayed without results. I've not found anyone that prayed and there was no result. So, Mark 13, this is like what we read before, but I will read it for a reason. Mark 13, 33. This is Matthew, kind of. Mark 13, 33. "Take heed, therefore. Take heed, watch and pray." Are you wondering why prayer is the top thing here? What's the first thing? Take heed. Second thing, watch. And we ignore the plan, just start praying. Why am I supposed to take heed? So that you don't waste your life doing what you think is prayer, yet it's not prayer. It's emptiness. Take heed. One, when you want to watch before you go into prayer. But let's pray. Take heed, watch, and pray. For you do not know where the time is. Why rubbish the first? The second is the third one, because that third one makes us feel so pious, religious, and very close to God. That's right. Even when you are praying, you are looking at your phone. When it just is some vibration, so you want to stop God. When it just I'm praying. I'm praying. Call me back. I'm praying. And what do you want? Okay, say it quickly. Because I'm praying. Yeah, that's what we call prayer. We have answered. Take heed, what? Give me an message here. So keep a sharp lookout. Look out for what? Signals. Flashes from heaven. Take heed. Watch out for signals. Don't just be like as others do. Watch out. Is a prayer point here or is just a waste of time? Watch out. Take heed. Be observant. Be vigilant. Watch out before you pray. When you pray, it does the matter. Everything is rearranged when you pray. But did you watch out for any signals? What did you see before praying? Give me an answer. You don't know the timetable. What does that tell you? You don't know when your baby will come. You don't know when you will get pregnant. You don't know. You do not know when the Lord will visit you. It could be the next 3 hours. He comes and you are like, oh, God. Oh, God, thank you. And you cry for joy. Say amen. Somebody will cry for joy very soon in Jesus' name. A good time to cry for joy. That which you never ever thought could take place again will take place in a short time from now. And you will shed tears. Nobody can console you because you will cry for days. Cry of rejoicing. In the name of Jesus. He was that person. Stand and shout amen, I believe it. Yeah. Look at this one. Since you don't know when that time will come, be on guard. Stay alert. People want alert, credit alert, but they don't stay alert. We have to stay alert more than wait for credit alert. Stay alert because the flashes that will come will be greater than the alert you are looking for. Yeah. Stay alert. Take heed. Watch. Then pray. So wait. I sense an unclean devil around me. At times I go to a place and I sense that a demon is in the place. I say, no, it's an unclean devil around me. Like, I rebuke you in the name of, get out of here. I'm here. I'm the light here. I have taken it. I had watched. Now I pray. It must happen. Don't just go to a place. You are the light of that place. Set them free there. Don't join them in the discussion that has no profit. You are the light of that place. They all may be in the Lord's fire, but you are the light. Not many. No, they are the light. They're just in church. And what I do? No. I said, there's something else. Can you tell me? Let's knock off. That's an unclean day for me. Or people are just fighting for no reason. At times I'm going and these people throwing stones at themselves. Big fight, bloodshed. And I say, no. Satan, I'm around him. He forgot you. I'm passing that by. I stopped that fight. I have stopped many fights like that. Many. They never knew I stopped the fight. Just when everybody would run away. I scattered them. Because that's where I'm the light. I can't be on the street driving like I'm walking, taking a walk, and there's a devil. I have to stop him. I am the light of the street. That's what I am. So no. Don't say, people call me. I don't send them. He didn't send them, but you can also make sure they are not sent to hell. He didn't send them to fight. The devil is sending them to hell. Call them back. Pray. I didn't say go into the midst of those who are throwing stones. But you can stop that demon from manifesting. That's why you are the light of that area. They may never know what you have done, but you know you stopped the fight. And the two people were fighting. For the new one brought a cutlass, another brought another thing. Negotiations, there were bystanders pouring petrol into the fire. And that one hit that one, but blood. That's not good. They look. They were encouraging them to kill them. And I stood there and said, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I give it to you. Stop. Showing yourself, gather them. And I insisted on that. I stood somewhere far away, watching, praying. Take heed. Watch. Pray. give you 2 months, you can close. Just these are things we don't know. We don't know the timetable. You don't know the timetable. Be ready, be prepared. You have to travel any day from today. You have to be in another country in the next 1 week. Be on the lookout. Stay sharp. Yeah! God might change everything you prayed for. When he told me, son, what are you doing here? My PhD said, I've not sent you here. I left you immediately. That was out of the sharp to know what. He didn't say leave. I knew the message. I got the message. I left. I didn't have to wait for him to say, get out of here now. No. That was clear. I have not sent you here. I didn't need to be told what to do. I left. 2 years ago. Today, to God's glory, my mates have been profs many years ago, professors, but wherever I love and respect, wherever they are, I am there too. But not all of them can be where I am. I enter places, I'm sorry, that many of them can't enter. Because, not because I'm better, but because of that thing. I took heed. I watched. And I prayed. To God be the glory. Hallelujah. Stay sharp. Be on the lookout. Anywhere you are, you are in a moving vehicle, or in a car, on a bike, on the plane, or driving your car, please be on the lookout. Because you are the Lord in motion. My God. When you appear, God has appeared. You are the Lord there. Are you not a God? Your neighbors are fighting and you leave them. No! You don't have to go into their midst so they don't wound you. You rebuke the devil. Stop the devil from continuing because if it gets blown beyond proportion, you will be a victim. Christians are not really doing what they have to do. Because if I'm looking for something, now I start to say to me, oh Lord, say to me, oh Lord, say to me, oh Lord. For how long God said to you? You have so much power that people are looking for. Help them. Set them free. Is that in our eyes? Just last 2 weeks or so, there was a big sound. So heavy. I ran to the window to see where. Mubuluwani ran from his room. Outside. To authenticate. Yeah. My wife also came. It was bad. But it was in our eyes. Can't operate here. Get out. And that was it before. And I now went out. I saw the man shouting. As I came out, he saw me, shouted the visible, and went outside the estate. And he got outside the estate, he tore his own clothes. Yeah. As he saw me, he moved. I didn't seem to go in. He saw me because I had met him once. By 2 weeks before that time. And he saw me, maybe thought I was coming to. So he was now trying to explain to me. I rebuked that devil opposing him. But now saw me, and I saw what I was saying. He just moved and went outside. And now tore his clothes outside. Why would you see your move? That's why you are there. You are the light. Don't let people keep themselves out of here. You are there. Why are you there? The reason you saw is that you might take something. Do something. Take charge. Can I have an amen? Yeah. In your office too. In your office, that's why you are there. Take charge. They may never know what you have done. Don't announce what you have done. If you announce it, and that they say that person, if he pray to kill you, the Bible will say, if a man used his cap to kill an elephant, and he said, and they watched him. Elephant was not elephant, everyone was an elephant. He moved his cap. Elephant just collapsed and died. That's the last day he is honored. As I'm following everybody around for me. Isn't it awesome? If there's argument here, the argument we do with this scarf, picking an elephant, it can just blow you. And you are gone, and you come to ashes. The only day is always that same day. Every day from that day is a devil. Everybody runs from him. So don't say what you have done. Just keep it your thank God that God answered you. I took that and God. It took place as I wanted. I didn't do that. Don't tell them what you have done. God, did you tell them? They won't like you again. So because people were enjoying the fight. So we're enjoying that cracker. So don't tell them. But they will know that your presence means something. They will begin to sense it. And this says once he comes around, peace takes place. That's your portion, Jesus. Amen. One more, and I'll let you go. Alright. Luke 9:55. In that, back up a bit. Luke 9. I will stop there. Luke 9. Maybe from 52. It's the messengers ahead to. Okay. Before his face, and as they went, they entered the village, okay, to prepare for him. Yes. Quickly go on. But they did not receive him because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. Ah, that's another day. Go on. The disciples, James and John, saw this. They said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down? Why wouldn't they receive you? Let's ask fire to consume them. That's the way we pray today. Let fire come down. If God, if I'm a child of God, let fire come down. It shows you don't know something. It's a, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did? You will think that's how arrogant we are today. We are so pompous. Christians are pompous, filled with self. We want to kill people at will and also raise the dead back to life. Our loved ones, we call them back to life. Those we hate, we kill them. We want both miracles, but none will happen because we are not broken yet. He turned and rebuked them sharply and said, you do not know what manner of spirit you have. I'll leave you with this scripture today. You don't know what manner of spirit you are made of. You don't know. You will think that would excite him. He said, oh yeah, call down fire. Why would they reject me? When you are rejected, it's part of the package. He was rejected here. Disciples said, no, let fire consume. They said, no. Rejection is part of it. Are you rejected by your loved one? That's part of it. Now, that's if you know what rejection means. Because being rebuked is not rejection. That you are corrected, rebuked, that's not when you are rejected. Or you ask for aid, assistance, it was not given, that's not when you are rejected. So, understand what rejection, this was rejection here. They did not accept him. He rebuked the disciples that said, he said, you do not know what manner of spirit you are of. Does that mean something to us today? In group meetings, family discussion, etc., in the office, in the marketplace, even in the church group meeting, wherever. And you find that people just don't accept your opinion, and you feel so sulky, you snub everybody, you will be like snail, trying to see, and some touches the eye, it goes in again, goes in, and takes some time before it can come out again. Don't open the eye like that. Some person respond to rejection like that. We feel so useless. No. Grow up. When you are rejected, it can be your biggest turning point in life. Love them again. Don't respond by calling down fire or by hating those who rejected you. Respond in love. Love does not fail. It has never failed because God is love.